Welcome everyone to this masterclass. For those that have been joining us for the first time, these masterclasses are in-depth knowledge sharing sessions given on specific technical topics by experts. Most of the time they can include live demo or source code analysis, depending on the speaker. Today we're gonna demystify APIs. So basically, we're going to talk about what is an API, how do you communicate with them, and how does this HTTP protocol fit in the picture. And today we're going to have Roy Dirks sharing his knowledge about APIs with you guys. We're very humbled that he actually took the time to give the session. We actually had, what was it, 2 months ago, a call together, and Roy was very like enthusiastic about sharing his knowledge and whatever he learned throughout his entire career with you guys. And today, basically, we're going to talk HTTP, right, Roy?
Yes, definitely. Thank you for the introduction. So let me share my screen with all of you. Yeah, so today I'm going to talk about HTTP and especially APIs, because HTTP is a protocol to communicate with APIs. So that's why it also in there. So what is this about? So you probably already heard about APIs, what APIs are, and maybe if you looked at other websites, or maybe if you already did some internship, you probably have been using APIs. So an API is a part of an architecture you would have whenever you have a web application, or sometimes even another application that's not for the web. Basically, an API is a way to abstract logic that's maybe in a web server or in a database and make it accessible to the internet. So from a web application or a mobile application, or even from another API, you could send requests to this API and then get information from maybe an underlying server or maybe a database. But those are things we're going to be discussing today and how that actually works. So for now, the only thing you need to remember is that APIs use HTTP and that you can use them to communicate between different systems or services. So a little bit about myself. As Victoria also said, I'm Roy. I'm also active on Twitter, so I think if you don't have a Twitter account yet, it's a great source of information. But it's a little bit of side note. It's also a confusing place of information because there are lots of different opinions. So I think it should be good to use Twitter, but use it wisely and don't get confused by all the different opinions on there. So currently, I work for a company called Vendebron, which you might know if you live in the Netherlands. They're making accessible renewable energy all over the Netherlands, so you could have an electricity contract or even a charge card for electric vehicles or charge points, or you can even get solar panels through us. So I joined them last summer, and over there we use technologies like React, TypeScript, GraphQL for APIs, if you might have heard about it. And before, I worked for lots of companies, some of them I founded myself, but also for the city of Amsterdam. So just as Codam, it's located in Amsterdam. And over there, the municipality is investing a lot of time into upgrading all the software that they have. And they even work a lot of open source. So if you would go to GitHub, you can even find an entire repositories filled with software that's being publicly made by the city of Amsterdam, which is quite cool, actually. I also work with lots of other companies. So if you want to know more about that, we can maybe use the Q&A later. And also, I've written some books about programming, and also went to a lot of conferences to speak about programming. And actually, Victoria told me there was also there might also be some people from Yerevan in Armenia. So I actually went to a conference in Yerevan 1.5 or maybe 2 years ago already. So nice to join you. I even saw your school, so it's really great that you're here. So let's go back to APIs. And for me, I'm a self-taught developer. So I think I was 14 years old when I started programming, all from my home, because I had an idea for a startup and I wanted to create a website for this. And the website also needed an API. So I think this was one of the first moments I actually learned about APIs. And I already told APIs are a way to abstract information from a server or a database and make it available. So that's why API is also short for an application programming interface. So it's an interface that you can use from an application, but it's also an interface on top of an application. But I think for now API is fine. I usually don't use the full word for things, but yeah, so APIs. So I already saw this picture before. We saw an API is more on the right side, and you use it to communicate with it from any web application or mobile application or other application, and it exposes your database or your server or any other logic to an application. So APIs are also often called backends. So if you know someone that's working on a backend system, then probably they're working with APIs, because APIs are usually a way to make the backend available to your frontend, and the frontend then would be, in example, the web application or the mobile application. And you can, in example, see this for Uber. If you're ever ordered to Uber, they are using APIs in order to talk with their mobile application. So this application is sending calls or over HTTP, which we'll see later. So it's sending requests to the API, and the API will respond with information. So this is what continuously is happening whenever you press buttons or whenever you're chatting somewhere in maybe in a Uber, but also in other applications. So every time you do something in a web application or a mobile application, often requests to an API are being sent. And whenever something changes on your screen, there will be a response, which you can then also see. So if you're chatting with someone, you're probably sending your own conversations or your own message. You're sending them to an API, and that API will respond with a message from someone else. So that's good to know, that whenever, no matter which website you're using or application, you're constantly sending requests to an API. And then underneath this API, there could be all sort of logic, but it's something you don't really have to know as you're just using this API in order to communicate with a product or maybe with a person or with any other services. So websites and API and apps get their data from APIs. So if you have a chat with someone else, then the data in the chat will come from an API, because that's the main way to expose information to someone else. And as I mentioned, there's something called HTTP. And HTTP is a protocol to request and respond from an API, but also talk with services through the browser. So your application is sending requests to the API over HTTP. And HTTP is a way to transfer information from an API to a browser, or it could also be the other way around. And HTTP is something, if you ever go to a website, you probably type in HTTP or HTTPS in order to, as a prefix to the actual actual website, because also whenever your browser opens a website, they're sending HTTP requests in order to load everything that you see in your screen. It's not only the data, but it's also, an example, the HTML or the CSS or images that you might be seeing there. So HTTP is really a way to transfer data or images, or data can also be images indeed, or maybe even JavaScript files all over the internet from the web to the API and back. So HTTP is also short for something, because I think we like to make words shorter in order we can speak more words. So HTTP is short for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So in the beginning, it was only used to transfer text. But now, of course, we have way more things that we transfer between websites and backends and other interfaces. So HTTP is really the main protocol in order to share data. And the data could be images, it could be JSON, it could be plain text, it could literally be anything. And something else that's good to know, that APIs cannot only be accessed from a web application or a mobile application, they can also be accessed through other APIs. So APIs are not only a way to connect a backend with a frontend, they could also be a way to connect a backend with a different backend that maybe in the end will connect to the frontend again, but it's not necessarily the case. So APIs are not only there to expose a backend to a frontend, but also to expose backends to other backends. And it's a really nice way to actually work together with other companies, or even work together within teams within a company in order to share data with each other. If you do it through an API, it's often more safe than directly give someone access to your database in order to share the data. But more about this later. But if you have an API that talks with other APIs or a service that connects with other services. We usually call it machine-to-machine communication. And machine-to-machine communication is a way to maybe connect multiple backends together, but also to connect different services together. Could also be an example, if you look at my case, with Van der Bron, we also have smart solar panels or smart wind turbines. Those are actually able to connect with our systems. And it's a machine, it's not a person connecting with it. So it's actually machine-to-machine communication. And this is all done through APIs. So that would look something like this, right? So previously we saw we have a API that exposes a database or a web server that connects with an application through HTTP. But the same goes for a different API. So this API could maybe also expose a database, or maybe it doesn't. It's not really important. But the main thing to know is that they also use HTTP in order to communicate with each other, unless they're all on the same system. But for now, it's easier to assume they're not. So HTTP is really the main protocol in order to communicate with APIs. And in order, before we learn more about APIs and actually look at some APIs, it's also good to know that there are different kinds of APIs. So one API is not really the other APIs, and APIs can be used in multiple ways. So there are three main types of APIs that we can actually have. So you either have a private API, a partner API, or a public API. So if we look at the one on the left, a private API. So a private API is usually something that's being used within an organization or a company, or maybe within a team. So it's an API that can only be used by a fixed set of people. So it could be all the people in the organization, could be all the people in the organization within multiple teams. And that's why they're also tailored to specific use cases. So if you have an internal or a private API, probably it's being used for one need. So it's either used to give data to a specific application, or it's being used to connect multiple applications together, or it's being used to expose data so it can be used by another part of the organization. So it's good to know it's tailored to specific use cases. So whenever you change something on the API, you have someone internally that's also been changing the way they're using this API. So it's really fluid. So you can change the API as long as you're connected to the people inside the company or the organization and you're all on the same level. You're going to change an API, you're going to maybe change the way you request data, or maybe you're going to change the data that's being returned. So if you have a private API, it's not a problem because you do all the communication inside your company or organization. And then we have something else called partner APIs, and they are a bit more different. I also chose a handshake in order to show what they are. I'm not sure if we will ever be giving handshakes again, but partner APIs are used by selected partners. So usually a partner API is a way to expose your data for selected partners. So maybe if your company or your organization wants to have a partnership with a different organization, then they can easily expose their data over APIs. So probably they will create a partner API that could be an abstraction on top of their internal APIs, or it could be a completely separate product. And you would often be charged in order to use it, or you would have some sort of agreement between both parties in order to use the API. So there's an example, could be an API if your company wants to work together with a different company and you need to communicate with data. Maybe one is an e-commerce and maybe the other one has a big warehouse where all the items are that needs to be shipped. Those are usually partner APIs. They're not open for everyone, but they're open for them if you're a partner and you want to work together. And that's why they also can be used for multiple use cases. So if you build a partner API, you typically don't build it for one partner, but maybe for multiple partners. So all those partners could want to be using your API slightly different. So that's why it's also a more generic API. It's more broad. It can be used for multiple use cases. And then finally, we also have a public API. So a public API can be used by anyone. And sometimes they have authorization, sometimes they don't. So there are like public APIs from search indexes, or even to look at the prices for cryptocurrencies. Those are typically public APIs, also for the weather. So it's information that should be available to anyone. And that's why it can also be used for many use cases. So they are specifically tailored to do as much as possible as people want to do with it. And that's why it also makes it easier to change them a bit, because if you change them and you add a field, it's not a problem. But if you delete a field, it will be more problems, because if people are using your API, you want to be able how they're using it. You want to see when they are using it, so you don't break anything. So that's why you should also say APIs are often contracts between parties. So if you go back to the previous slide, you can see you have a private API. In there, the contract is not really important, because you can change your APIs as long as you communicate internally with the company. If you have a partner API, you maybe charge money for it, or you're using an API from a partner, then you don't want them to be changing that much, because if they change something, you also need to change something. You need to communicate with a lot of different parties. Maybe they need to change some logic in their applications, and maybe they don't even have their own developers. So with partner APIs, and specifically with public APIs, APIs are really a contract, because whenever you agree to use someone else's API, you need to be secure that nothing will change in that API, or if something does change, that you will be let know whatever changes and how you can actually make changes to your product in order that it keeps working. So that's why we often say APIs are contracts between parties, because if you change them, something will break somewhere, because yeah, you can't change code automatically from an API. Or at least you can, but you often need to deploy it somewhere. So it's not really something people can do. Just change APIs, and because then you're breaking contracts. And also the API specification can also be seen as a contract. So an API has a schema, just as a database sometimes have, which is also linked to the documentation. This actually means whenever you change something to the schema or the setup of the API or the API specifications, you're going to break a contract. So that's why it's really important that whenever you expose APIs or whenever you use APIs, you make sure that everything is documented well, and also that if you want to change something, that you know who to communicate to whatever you have changed. So maybe you've been using APIs before. So it could be from social media, or maybe from news websites, or from websites that expose other kind of data, maybe related to COVID cases or maybe related to the weather. Now, they all have APIs, and they often have a change log in which you can see whatever changed to the API. And often they also have like a blog in which you can see whatever they will change. So that's really focused around the concept that APIs are contracts. And there are actually three main specifications for APIs. And this is not the most important thing I want to show you today, but it's good to know. So in the very beginning, or maybe at least when APIs became popular, APIs were often called SOAP APIs. And those were using XML in order to communicate. So if you want to get data from a SOAP API, you would retrieve XML. And XML is always in the same format. You can expect the same fields in there. But also, because it's XML, it's difficult to use. It requires lots of code. So this is actually a really old protocol. This is one of the first. It was also created by Microsoft, because they've been around for a long time, and they were at the forefront of a lot of technical innovations that we still use today. And SOAP is still used today, but it's not the most important API specification just yet, because a lot of companies aren't actually using it anymore because they moved to REST. So REST APIs are typically the most popular APIs, and they can support multiple formats. So you can have a REST API that returns JSON, which is usually the case, but it can also return HTML or plain text or even images. So REST API calls are most of the API calls that you see today. And they also return fixed data structures. So whenever you send a request to a REST API, you can expect data in the same format every time you send a request to it. And it's by far the most popular specification, but it's also quite old. I think it's been around since somewhere in the early 2000s. So maybe even it's been older than some of you. And the REST format is working fine, and it's still working for most of the web, but it wasn't sufficient for most use cases that people have. So that's why Facebook invented GraphQL. That's somewhere like 2014 or 2015. And GraphQL is also based on JSON. But the main advantage is that it has flexible data structure. So you can determine whatever data will be returned based on the schema of this API. So a GraphQL API is less of a contract than a REST API is, making it more flexible and also making it popular for front-end applications. So if you want to know more about any of these kind of APIs, we can use the Q&A for it. But as I mentioned, it's good to know, but it's not the most important thing to know about APIs. And I think most companies, you will be working with, or maybe most projects you will be building, they are sufficient by using REST APIs because it's the most popular specification out here today. And what's also important about REST APIs or APIs in general is that you need to secure them. Because if you're exposing data to other companies, to other people, maybe even to the public, then you want those APIs to be secured. And that's actually already starting in your browser. So you can have security by using HTTPS instead of HTTP. It's not really making your application secure or your API secure, but it is making sure that whatever goes in the browser is being encrypted in order to have a safer experience. And I think also if you're working maybe in e-commerce or you want to create something that has payments in there or authentication of users, then typically you're actually required to use HTTPS because most browsers will actually tell you this, HTTP is wrong and HTTPS is right. Because HTTP is exactly the same as HTTPS, but it's not encrypted and it's less secure. So whenever today for the rest of the talk, if I will be using HTTP, then I probably mean HTTPS because that's now the most safest protocol in order to do so. And it's also the standard protocol. But people still tend to use HTTP because I think that's just what we're used to. And also you can secure the endpoints or the protocol by using HTTPS instead of HTTP. But also you want to have deeper authentication for your APIs because still it doesn't sufficiently protect your data from someone else because you maybe also want to limit the amount of data someone can see or maybe limit if they can even see whatever data you have available. So that's why you would use authentication in your API. And for this, there are more ways to secure an API, but I think the three main things you see for APIs are either having no authentication at all, so all the data is available to everyone, you can send a request and return the data. And there's also, it's just a downside, there's no track record of who accessed your data. So if you have a public API or a partner API, or a private API, and you have no authentication at all, then it's really hard to see whoever used your application. You can maybe track IP addresses, but you will never know who's the user of your API. So that's why I typically prefer not to use authentication. Because yeah, you lose the advantage of seeing who's using the API, and if you know who's using it, then maybe you can also find out how they're using it, why they're using it in such a way, and you can even improve it. So that's why many companies also have API keys. So with an API key that's linked maybe to an organization, a company, or maybe even to a person, if you have an API key, you can see who's the key you're using from. So if you're in a if you're a partner or if you're someone else using that API and you ask them to create an API key using your system, then you always know whoever sent a request to your API. And you can also see who are the biggest users of your API. You can even see, let me look at their products, see what they're actually doing with your API. And you could also set on all sorts of things such as rate limiting, because maybe you don't want someone to send a request to your API every second. So API keys are very useful. But API keys are also not the safest way to do so. So that's why we have OAuth flow. And with OAuth, you actually request a user to go to a login page where they will fill in the user credentials and then a token will be returned. And a token will serve as the API key. So using that token, someone can use that API in order to get information from it. So OAuth is, I think, the most used way for APIs, and it's also the most secure way. So most applications that you see are using OAuth, which means that you can also give other companies access to your APIs. So maybe you've been using social logins from Google or Facebook or Apple. Those are all using the OAuth flow. So if someone requires you to log in by Facebook or Google, then they will be using the APIs from those companies and their OAuth flows in order to create a token for you so they can talk with their APIs using your information. So OAuth flows are a very important way in order to do authentication for APIs. And it looks something like this. So you would have a client, which is maybe a mobile application or a web application. Someone fills in a login form on your website, and then they will be requested to allow certain things. So maybe you ask someone in order to see their social feeds, or maybe you want to read through their emails. I don't think that's something you want other companies to do, but some companies request that. So it's always important if you use social login to see whatever sort of things they're requesting for you. But the most important is that they'll return a token, and a token can be used by the other application in order to authenticate as you. So they can use their APIs using your information and thereby giving you a better user experience. So OAuth Flows, it's a lot to tell about it, but it's good to know. But it's okay if you don't really understand or master the details just yet, because then again, this talks about APIs and not about authentication. But it is an important important aspect of APIs that you at some point will learn more about. So let's get back to HTTP, because we already saw that HTTP is a protocol to talk with APIs from a web application or from a mobile application, and even from a different API. And HTTP is okay, but it's better to use HTTPS as we saw, and maybe you also want to add extra layers of authentication to your API. But for now, let's look at HTTP and how we can use it in order to communicate with APIs. So HTTP, in case you forgot, is Hypertext Transfer Protocol, or HTTPS is Hypertext Transfer Protocol Secured. So it's actually a secure version of HTTP. And HTTP is actually this part. So we have a web server or application API on the right. We have the actual application on the left, and they're sending requests to the API, and the request and the response, they are served over HTTP. And there are different standards within HTTP. So HTTP 1.1 is what the web is mostly using today. And HTTP 1.1, it has one downside. And maybe if you ever looked at the console tab of your browser, you can actually see HTTP 1.1 is working synchronous. So you have to wait for other requests to succeed before you send a new request. So it's actually slower. There is something called HTTP 2.0, but it's not used by every application yet. But then you can ask multiple requests in parallel. So it's actually faster. But for now, most APIs still use HTTP 1.1. And it's something you can see if you would go to a browser and inspect what's going on whenever you visit a website. So this is actually the website of Van der Brunn, the company I'm working for. And you can see on the right, you can see all the requests that are being made. And on the left, you can see the actual page. So this is my usage. As you see, I don't have a smart meter just yet, which hopefully I will get at some point, and I can actually have real-time vision on whatever is happening in my house in terms of energy. But what you see on the right is actually, you can see whenever you open a website and you click on you have a right mouse click, you can find something like inspect, and then you can find the network tab. And in the network tab, you can see all the requests that are being made by this website to APIs, and also to get images or JavaScript files or CSS files, or maybe even fonts, because a lot of websites are using fonts. But you can also see a list of APIs that this website is requesting. So you can see something called token or user info, details. This is all information that everyone can see. And if we click on one of those requests, you can also see what the request looks like. So you can see if we click maybe on the, I think I selected the user info, you can see here that I have a request URL, which is the Van der Brunn API /user info. I also have a request method, more about it later, and also a status code and response headers and request headers, preview, response. There's a lot of information there. So it's quite easy to get distracted by whatever's going on. But the first step here is to actually see and know that web applications are using APIs. And you, as a user, no matter how advanced you are, you can find the network tab and see what kind of APIs they're been calling. And then if you click on any of those requests, you can actually see what information is being returned by this API. And you can also see if all the requests are okay. So sometimes I even find myself debugging other websites. So if you're working on a web application or an API and you maybe even are working on full stack code, then probably you spend a lot of time in the network tab to see whatever is going on. But sometimes I even find myself if a website doesn't work. So recently, I was registering a new company with the KVK in the Netherlands, so the Chamber of Commerce, and I didn't see an error message on their screen. So I was kind of worried, whatever is going on. Then I opened the network tab and actually saw that whenever I upload a PDF of over 200 kilobytes, the websites give an error. But you don't see the error as a user. But if you're a developer, if you know how the network tab works, I actually found that the API returned an error because the file was too big. So it actually helped me to proceed and fill in the form to create a new company. But it's it's how things work. And it's also nice to see that through the network tab, you can see how an application is communicating with APIs. So this is also something to watch out for, because if you have information that you share with users and they shouldn't be able to see it, so maybe your API also has data that you don't want users to see, make sure to secure it using authentication so people don't see information that they shouldn't see just by going to the network tab. And then, of course, here we have something else I shortly mentioned, like the request method and also the status code, but I will tell more about it later. So we already saw that what APIs are, that we have different kinds of APIs. So we have APIs that communicate with web applications, maybe with mobile applications, but also machine to machine. So that's an API talking with another API or a backend talking with another backend. We also saw we have different kinds of APIs. So we have private APIs, we have public and partner APIs, and they might also require authentication, and everything is served over HTTP. So this is all the information I gave you so far. But you don't really look into HTTP, what it's doing, and how you would make a request to an API using HTTP. So that's actually the most important part, and it's also the most hands-on part, because for now I've been talking almost half an hour about a lot of logic, so let's have a more deep dive into actually the technology itself. So let's zoom in on HTTP, or HTTP 1.1, or maybe even 2.0, if you're working on something that's a bit more modern. So if we look at a HTTP request, it consists of multiple things. So the most important part for an HTTP request is actually the request URL. So often it is something like HTTPS, and then some slashes, and then myapi.com/a certain endpoint. So the request URL is the point where you start. So you would need a request URL in order to send a request over HTTP to an API. And then the second most important thing is also the method, because there are different ways to get information from an API. Because you can do a GET request. So a GET request is like a read-only one. So you will get information from an API, but you're not changing anything on the API side. So all the other parts like POST, PUT, PATCH, and DELETE, and there are some more, but these are the most important methods. Those are all used to send information to an API. So the GET request is the only one where you will only pull information out of the API, but don't push any information to it. So POST, PUT, PATCH, and DELETE, they're all used to transfer information to an API. And then your API, depending on the logic that's in the API, will maybe add some rows to the database, it will maybe delete them, or maybe edit them. So that's what you handle with the request methods. And then we have headers. So headers are extra information you would give to an API. So in the header, an example, you can give the API information about the format of the data you're sending or about the format of the data that you want to receive. But you can also use them to send your API key or your API token. So you would have custom headers for authentication. You maybe even have custom headers to send cookie information to it, or maybe some other variables that you want to share. So if you want to share variables or about either your environment or the user, or maybe other details, then usually you do it through the headers. And then, not when you're using a GET request, but if you're using a POST, PUT, PATCH, of DELETE, or maybe some of the other request methods that are used to mutate or change data, then you also want to have a body. So in the body, you will put all the data that you want to send to the API. So I think these four things are the main key to the main ingredients to have an HTTP request. So we start with the request URL. So this is the URL of our API, or maybe even the endpoint for a specific part of our API. We have the method, often it's GET. I think maybe another position is often POST. Sometimes it's PUT, PATCH, or DELETE, but the most important ones are GET and POST. And of course we have headers in order to determine how we want to return the data, how we want to receive the data, and which format, but also to add things like authentication. And then finally, the body is something you would use not on a GET request, but on all the other ones, because you want to send information over HTTP to the API. And then whenever your request is successful, or even if it isn't, you will receive a response. So the response will come from the same URL as you sent the request to. So we don't have to look at the request URL if we send something to the API. But what we do have to look for is the status code. So I put down some status codes and also some ranges. I think the best status code you could get is a 200, because 200 means it's okay, it's successful. And then there are variations of 200 in order for specific use cases. So if you would Google HTTP status codes, you can find all the information and a complete list, but 200 is always the best response. And then you could, in example, have 301, which is a redirect. So those are something you would have maybe in an OAuth flow. So whenever you send credentials to an API, maybe they will redirect you to a different endpoint where you can get more information. We have 404, which is not found, so it's not a good one. Usually this happens when the endpoint or the API that you want to call doesn't exist, or maybe that certain endpoint doesn't exist. And in the 400 range, there are more of these status codes that actually tell you there's an error. The same as for 500 or 501. So the 500 range is also about errors or warnings. But as I mentioned, 200 is the most important and the one you should focus on. But there are way more, and even some Easter eggs in there. I believe there's also a status code about cats. So it's quite funny to look into it. But as I mentioned, there's a complete long list, so make sure to Google it whenever you find the time. And the response will also return some headers. It will return custom headers and standard headers. So standard headers will tell you maybe about the format of the data, which is also important. But you can also use it to receive information about authentication. And then the HTTP response also comes with a body. So this is the data that you will get from the API. So typically all the API endpoints that you would call will return you some data. And with this data, you can do something else. You can use it to display the implication. You can save it maybe through a different API. But at least the body or the response is the one that's interesting, because whenever you're sending a request to an API to get a web page, the response will maybe be HTML, CSS. But if you send something to an API to get data, then typically it will be JSON or maybe even plain text. So the HTTP response is the place where you would get your data back. So how to use it? There are multiple ways to use APIs. So you could use an API through curl, and curl is something that you can access from your terminal, and curl typically works with every terminal and every machine. But it is a downside. It has limited functionalities. There isn't that much documentation inside the browser, inside the terminal. So from the terminal, you cannot see everything that you can do with the API, because curl is just curl working in the terminal and tailored to a specific need if you wanted to send a request to an API. But curl is quite cool. We actually will be looking at curl in a few moments. And then there are apps to use APIs. The most popular one is Postman. They recently had even their remote conference where I was speaking about all the new technologies and all the new things they will be shipping to users. And the advantage of Postman, it's a really user-friendly interface, even developer-friendly. So in Postman, you can make a collection of APIs that you use. You can also save and store them. It sort of works like an IDE, but then for APIs. So it's quite cool to do it from Postman and really explore the one, because opposed to curl, it's a bit more user-friendly, and it's also has possibilities to save requests. And then finally, you can, of course, communicate with APIs through code. So it can be from a front-end application, it can be from a different API, it can be from any programming language that you can think of, because most of them support sending API requests. But that's something we won't cover today, because it's not really agnostic. So Postman and curl are something you can use no matter what programming language you're using. But if you want to use it from your code, you would really have to look at the programming language that you use and what kind of libraries or built-in features or methods they will have in order to communicate with APIs. So let's try this. So to try this, I actually you can do this yourself as well. You can go to this this website. So this website is from Swagger, and Swagger is a tool to document APIs, and they will have an example documentation for one of their APIs. And it's actually a very nice, straightforward way in order to learn more about this. So if you would go to this website, you would basically end up here. If you would go here, you can see, well, a collection of endpoints. So these are endpoints that are made available by this Swagger. And Swagger is a way to document it. So in here, we can see we have HTTP. And we actually have multiple endpoints. So we have endpoints to do posts, actually to upload data or to add something to a database. We have something for put to update them. But we also have GET requests. So let's look at some GET requests, because they have one request in order to get information of a pet, determining on the status. And in here, you can find all the information that you want. But you also have a button to try it out. So let's try it out and see what they actually do. So this is all documentation that you could add to an API, but you not necessarily have to. But the nice thing is they will also show you how to do curl. So if we would copy this command and we would go to a terminal, you could actually copy paste this and you can see we're using curl, we're using X, which is the method get. So we want to get information. This is our endpoint. So it's the petstore.swagger. It's like the base URL for our API. You can see we want pet, we want to find by status, and we also have some query parameters like the status. So if you look at this, we're doing a curl request. We want to get information from an API, and we want to get all the pets that are available. And then the important part down here is that we also add the header. So with the flag, with the header, we can say we're going to accept application/JSON. So we're going to tell curl and the API that we want to accept data in a JSON format. So if we would press enter, it will get this information from this API. And as you can see, it's a lot of JSON. So it's kind of, it's probably whatever they're doing. If you look at a movie and they're hacking in the past, they would probably scroll down terminals like this to give you the example that they're really hacking stuff. But this is with curl. And with curl, you can just, we can also look at what happens if we don't add a status. If we want to leave out a status. But then we actually don't get a response because the API expects us to give us a status. You can also maybe try giving it the wrong status, see whatever happens then. We can see still nothing happens because probably what's happening is that this API is returning us data that we can parse in here because we don't see the status code. So we actually want to see the status code. And for that we can use Postman. So Postman, as I mentioned, is a way to talk with APIs from a user-friendly interface. So in Postman, we can say we want to have a GET request or maybe a POST, a PUT, a PATCH. We're going to send the endpoint to it, and then we can just press send. And we're going to send information to the API. And here you can see we're sending this request. We get a status OK, but actually it's not OK because we didn't put in a variable. Maybe we can say see what happens whenever we add a wrongly variable. So yeah, this is a typically not a very well-designed API because as a user, you want to know that this is a wrong status. But still, we can use a correct status, which is available, and then see what happens. So in here, you can also see you would have the JSON. You can see the headers that are being returned. So often they return the date, but they also return the content type. So we would know we would have actually JSON because JSON is something we can easily parse. These are the headers that we sent. There's also some hidden ones. Like for encoding or what kind of data we want to accept. So with Postman, you really have more flexibility. You can also maybe have a look at some other things. So maybe we want to update an existing pet. So probably this will give us some errors. So we can try this out. You can even execute it through here in order to get the curl information. So here we can use curl again, and you can even see with curl, you can also send a body. So the flag for D is actually the one to post a body. So using this curl request, we're going to do a put request and see it on this flag. We're going to have an endpoint. We're going to say what kind of data we're sending, but also what kind of data we want to receive. And we also send along a body of JSON. So if we would do this curl, it would add information to the database. And the response will be the kind of information we just added. So we can see the response of the API is the ID, which is the ID that's automatically generated, category that we added to it. So ID 0, name string, the name is doggy. So all these things are added here. And maybe this API will give us some errors if we leave out certain parts. But it's something we can also try through Postman. So let's maybe go with Postman and get this URL here. So we can do a GET request, which will maybe return us some data, or maybe it won't. Yeah, so it's unknown. So this actually meaning 405 method not allowed. So doing a GET request on this endpoint is not allowed, because this was, of course, a PUT request. So we can try that. And then we also get another error code, unsupported media type, because we have forgotten something. So we maybe haven't set the correct headers, or maybe we haven't put a body. So we can also set the headers of our content type, because you want to let them know what kind of data we sent. We can do it here, so content type, rest. And of course, we also need to append the body. So that's something we could post here. What do we have? We don't really have this. Let's try. Yeah, so this is okay. So now we're sending the headers, and the headers here are important because with this header, we're actually letting the API know that we're going to be sending JSON to them. So this body is formed of JSON. So those are two really nice ways to look at APIs and actually to use them. And they are can be used on top of the documentation that the API already has. So this Swagger or open API definition is a way to document APIs, but there are many more ways. So I'm sometimes I watch the Rick and Morty show. They actually also have a nice API, which you can also find here. And they also have cool documentation, but it looks a bit different. But in here, again, you can also find the APIs that you're using. And it could be a nice way that typically whenever I give workshops to learn people how to make front-end applications, I'd be using the Rick and Morty API as a starter point. So if you want to look at an API that's maybe a bit more cool, you can also have a look at the Rick and Morty API and see how they're doing things. So we can even try and look at it from Postman, see whatever will happen, because we can do a GET request. You don't actually have a body. And you can see you can also use any API just from Postman. And we could also do a curl request, of course, even to the Morty API, because both things will work with every API, unless we have authentication, of course. You could also do this and then get all the information in here. So curl and Postman, they're both cool ways to interact with APIs, and they're both also agnostic. So no matter on what API you're using or how you're using it or whatever programming language you want to use in your backend or your frontend, you can still investigate those APIs. And they can also be used on top of the existing documentation for these APIs. So that was it from my side. If you have any questions, and probably you have, we can now take all the time to answer them for you. And also, if you want to connect to me on Twitter, feel free to do so, and also to ask extra questions there later on in case you can't think of them now. So thanks a lot, and then I think we can head over to the questions.
Thanks a bunch, Roy. We indeed have one question so far in the Slido, but I would like to encourage everybody to include their questions right now. So take 2 or 3 minutes, guys, to actually include your questions. Once again, the link is in the comments, right? And it's as well in your email. I've sent you today an email with the right links. Meanwhile, I have a question myself. So you mentioned something about APIs are being used in machine-to-machine communication, right?
Yes.
And looking into the future, in my opinion, machine-to-machine is going to be a thing. It's already a thing, right? With this all these IoT devices talking between each other. So I was wondering how APIs would play a role. And in order for us to have a secure system, right, like using just this APIs, is it good enough, or are we risking, you know, later on to become in trouble?
Yeah, so APIs are a way to expose your data and also to have your data used by other companies or even machines. So that's why authentication is important, and also to think about whatever you put in your API. So often you see that APIs are related to a database, because most of the time you just want to have a database that you want to make available to other people. It's always good to think about if you want to do that and what kind of data you want to expose. So sometimes you see APIs that are being used by other applications, but also for like an admin dashboard. So if you would have maybe even for Codom, an admin dashboard in which you could keep track of all the students, there might be an API around it, but it's not something you want someone else to see, because it's important information. It's also personal. So that's especially why authentication is important. And I think it was some time ago, maybe a few weeks, that even a Dutch company, they helped Zoom finding one of a box in their system through APIs. So it's always important to secure them and to really make sure that all the data that you expose is data that you want to expose, and also that you have the correct authentication on it. But definitely it will be more and more important, because APIs are really a good way to interact. And as I mentioned, APIs are also a contract, so you want to be sure that wherever you expose the API to is aware of how they can use it and what information is in there.
Okay. I can see already coming, like a couple of questions coming in. So maybe I should kickstart taking them one by one, if that's okay with you.
Yes, definitely.
Let's start with the last one that was just in. What is the most common language to use here? I think programming language they mean, right?
Yeah, so that's the nice thing about APIs, is that it doesn't really matter. So you you can create APIs in Python, in Node. You can even do them in C. You can basically, every language you can create an API. The only thing that you need to do is expose them to the internet. So you want to have a server running somewhere that has the API. And you would also need a database, most of the times, of course, because you want to expose data that's coming from somewhere. So there isn't really a most used language, other than if you look at languages that are popular now for web applications or web servers. I think it's a lot of Python, a lot of Node. So these are popular languages to write APIs in. But you also see languages like Go or Rust. They're becoming more and more popular, especially because they're really good with large data sets. But it doesn't really matter, and that's also the nice way. So that's also why I chose to use Curl and Postman in order to show how to use APIs, because the nice thing is that they're agnostic and they can be used for basically any system.
Sweet. Thanks a bunch. Did you end up fixing Kavika's mistake and contacting them to get it done, updated? If so, can you charge them for debugging it?
Yeah, I did send them an email, because the in the end, I couldn't compress my my PDF small enough. Like 200 kilobytes for a large PDF is quite, it's not really doable. So in the end, I just uploaded the first page, and then someone contacted me through email, and then I gave them the feedback. So I think it worked out. I haven't checked again, so maybe I need to start some more companies to see if they if they fix the page. But yeah, I think there are a lot of companies that are actually making it available for other people to try and debug their products or try to come up with solutions. So it could be a nice way for people to learn more about programming, but also a nice way to earn some extra money, because companies are also looking for like ethical hackers or people trying to find bugs in their system. So I don't really have a website at hand now, but there are definitely websites on which you could find companies that are open for these kind of constructions.
And maybe to open the parenthesis for the students that are international, Kavika is the Chamber of Commerce. So it's a very big institution in the Netherlands where all the companies are registered, just for your information. Next question. If a server uses REST API, is it hard to change to GraphQL API?
Yeah, so a GraphQL API. So it depends. So you have libraries that automatically do it for you. But if you would go to YouTube and type in my name and then GraphQL and REST, then probably you can find some talks on how to do it. Yeah, there's a lot of different the different formats. So GraphQL has a lot of advantages that REST doesn't have. But yeah, you could automatically morph them. But yeah, it doesn't really matter what you're using as long as you're happy with what you're using.
Okay. Next up, what is mainly lacking from the fixed data structures like REST?
Yeah, so the APIs that I showed you today, those are REST APIs, which mean they also have a fixed data structure. So at one point I showed the terminal with a lot of data. That's actually a fixed data structure. So no matter when or what you're doing with the API, if you're calling that endpoint, you will get all that data. Well, maybe if you look at, maybe you create an application that uses this API, but you're only using one or two fields, and you're getting a lot of data that you don't want to have inside your application. So if you have fast internet, then it's fine. But if you have slower internet, or maybe you don't have an unlimited data bundle, then you'll be retrieving all this information that you aren't using. So it's way harder for browsers to render it, or for a bandwidth and able to be able to do this. And why Facebook came up with GraphQL was actually because in 2015, our mobile phones were way slower, our internet was way slower. So we actually needed less data to be transferred in order to have a fast application. But today, I think a lot of those problems are solved. Yeah, but a nice thing of having flexible data structures is being able to have one API that can be used by a lot of people, and they can all use it differently without having to see the data that other people are using. So it is a nice way to make it easier. But if you have a small API or you never have to change the fields, then REST is still perfectly fine, and it's not really a problem to have fixed data structures as long as you agree to the contract that a REST API is.
And the next question is actually sort of related. So if a server uses REST API, is it hard to change it to a GraphQL API?
Let me check. Oh, I think we already answered this, right?
I think that the other one was not about REST, it was about different one. Or yeah, okay, so it was it answered? Maybe you can repeat yourself just for the sake of it, that it doesn't matter.
Yeah, so it doesn't really matter if you're using REST or GraphQL, as long as you make sure that you choose the right tool for whatever you want to do.
Somebody again, anonymous. It's so interesting. They all write just anonymous. Hello, Roy. Many thanks for your presentation. Lots of new things learned. Maybe you have any Coursera or other MOOC to recommend to dive deeper into APIs?
Yes. So if you want to learn more about APIs, you could, of course, go to some online community in order to learn. So but I think it really depends on what you want to learn. So interacting with the API is fine. There isn't that much to it. So if you try it out, you try different APIs, you look at documentation, you can find out either through curl or Postman on how to use it. But if you want to build your own API or you want to access an API through code, then it's a bit hard to recommend something because there are many programming languages in order to build APIs, but also to consume them. So it really depends on what you're doing. I believe I found a APIs for Dummies book that I previously shared with you, Victoria, as well. So maybe
I will be
you can find the link again and share it with the students.
I will share it exactly after this this masterclass. Next question: do you have any interesting examples of cases where API specs changed and it broke something important?
Yeah, so I think this is happening mostly every day, especially if you have internal APIs or you work with different teams together. If multiple teams are able to change the API and maybe you've been on a holiday for a couple of days and you get back, probably you can find some fields that have changed. So usually if you have internal APIs, then the spec will change all the time, which could be fine as long as you communicate it. But if you have bigger companies, then you can also find maybe with partner or public APIs that the spec can also change. And usually they have some sort of deprecation schema. So they will have a new version of the API released, and they will usually keep the old version running for some time. So this is something you see happening all the time. So maybe if you try integrate with maybe Facebook or Google. You can see they have multiple versions of their APIs, and they keep changing. And usually they also communicate a end of life date for an API. So they will tell you you can use API version maybe 2.1 until the end of May 2022. And then after that, a new version will be released that you can use after that. So you often see applications that aren't updated that often, that something will break because the API changed. And specifically if they don't use versioning for the API, or if maybe the versioning is also implicit. Sometimes you also see you have to specify a version of the API in order to use that version. Otherwise, you just use the latest one. So I do have some websites that I built a couple of years ago, and I didn't really touch them anymore. And then sometimes if you open them again after a couple of years, you see something's broke, usually because APIs are no longer working, or maybe they're deprecated. So it is something you see usually happening all the time. So if you have an API that you want to monetize, it's been used by partners, just make sure to have a clear versioning, have deprecation set up, and also to communicate every time you change something so people can know what to expect.
I found a very interesting question. If you create APIs connected, let's say, your own company's database, are you legally responsible for the data you expose?
Yeah, so it depends on what kind of data it is. So if I have data that is anonymous, data that's maybe not important or not directly linked to a person, then it should be fine. So if I would have an e-commerce store and I have e-commerce data like products and prices, all those things, if I want to share them with people, then it is fine because it's my own data. But whenever you store user information, then you need to also tell the Dutch government that you're storing user information. There's like this big file of like 30 pages in which you, if you're using user information, you need to sign it. And also make sure that you use the data in a correct way. So they will ask you all sorts of questions about how you're using the data, why you're using the data, how you're storing it, how you're securing it. So for most data, it's fine unless you have user information, which is secured by the Dutch government, or maybe you have information that's not yours. So maybe if you go back to the e-commerce example, maybe you also store information about brands that they want to, that they maybe have a copyright on. And that's something you're not allowed to share unless you have specific agreements with them. So it's always important to think about what data you have and how you store it. And even as simple as maybe you start a website tomorrow and you start saving email addresses, names, birthdates, those kind of things, that's something you would have to think about because you could get a big fine if you expose the data and you didn't sign the right agreements. Yeah. So it is important to think about these things.
Especially with the new regulations related to the GDPR, now is getting more and more relevant to look into this.
And yes, definitely.
And there is one also related question, might be the same, but let's take it just to see if we indeed tackled it. What's an example of sensitive data that shouldn't be seen in the network tab at DevTools? So this is the same question, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know what's a network tab, so I'm not a technical person.
The network tab is, so if you would go to any web page, you can use your right mouse click and press inspect. Hmm. And then you can get all sorts of information about the website. But you can also see all the requests that are being done to APIs.
Yeah.
So if you have sensitive data in an API that other people can see, then it's something you you want to make sure that you don't expose it. So sometimes you see companies giving this away, maybe by... there are some examples of e-commerce stores that actually were being caught because they gave discounts on the original price. And then if you would go to the network tab, you look at the APIs, and you can see the discount price is actually just the regular price, but they sort of try to mislead people into thinking they made a big deal. So those are things you shouldn't share, or to begin with, you shouldn't try to mislead people. But if you do so, make sure to hide your data.
Yeah. Let's take the next one. There are a couple of unrelated questions to the API, so I'm going to leave them for the end. So I'll take only the API related ones for now. So what's the difference between a simple web request, example connecting to my favorite news website, and an API request?
Yeah, so it's typically the same. So your application or your browser actually will also send HTTP request or HTTP request, HTTPS request to a web server in order to get your website. So there are multiple kinds of APIs. So usually what we say is an API is a layer that gives information that's typically data. But you also have web requests like getting your website, but this website is also requested over HTTP or HTTPS. But then it's not JSON, but typically it's HTML or CSS, and that's being rendered by a browser. Maybe it's even JavaScript. So there are some differences, but still all the protocols are the same. But the need is different. So a simple web request, so connecting to the news website, is just sending something to a server. And a server is not necessarily an API, but an API is something that's specifically made in order to send information to you.
Yeah, pretty clear. And another very straightforward question. Where do you insert the API key? In the header or in the body?
Yeah, so that it depends. So typically what you see, it's either in the headers, because the body is to send information that you you want to mutate or you want to save somewhere to the request, but it's often in the headers or in the query parameters for the URL. So either people append it to the URL, so you maybe have your API endpoint and then you add some query parameters like a question mark and then API key is, and then you can insert it there, or you put it in the header. But it depends on the specification of the API.
Okay, pretty clear. I can notice that the students are a bit like overwhelmed by this GraphQL and REST and all this format. So another question is, when do you pick GraphQL and over REST and vice versa?
Yeah, so I think to get back to that point, I think it's important to first understand the APIs before you can understand the solution for the question. So typically you want to use GraphQL if you want to have flexible data structures and REST if you don't. But it also depends on what you're already doing. So if you're already using REST APIs, then it's perfectly fine to have them. If you want to have more flexibility, you can look at GraphQL. But the concepts for both are the same, especially if you start on a new project. I think it's best to first really master APIs and how to build them before you try to look at comparing different specifications. So I think if you're a beginner, then it's actually better to start with REST, because then you will know what old APIs look like. And then if you learn GraphQL, you know what the newer APIs look like. So I think the best tip for today is maybe try to start with REST first and then see how they work.
Yeah, it's the same attitude as quorum 42 overall, that we say learn C, so learn the old language and then all the other languages will follow. So learn REST in this case, and then you can adapt towards GraphQL. Actually, it's interesting. The students are having API projects, and they have to come up with an interesting project, you know? So the question is, we have Codam API and students already build something based on it. However, it's tough to invent new projects. So maybe you can inspire them with like a potential project or angle that they could go mm-hmm. for their project.
Yeah, so if you already have an API, you can also try to extend it, try to build new APIs on top of it. So that's something you could do, but it's always, I personally am a big fan of hackathons. So in there you can also get ideas about how to use different data. So it also depends a bit on what kind of APIs you already have in order to think of new projects. But something you could think about is try to merge different data sources together. So maybe you can think about merging weather data together with Codam information. Maybe that could be a nice way if you have the attendance rate maybe of certain classes or of certain projects. Maybe you can merge with weather data and actually see if the weather influences how much people are there on Codam, or maybe even with public public travel information. So there are different ways to use APIs together and then see if you can go to come to new information. So maybe based on the weather, you can predict if it will be a quiet day at Codum. So it could be the perfect day for you to work on your project. Well, maybe if you see it will be bad weather and there's no, there's good traffic, then probably it will be quite busy.
Actually, I do have a suggestion in this case. So I'm not sure if I mentioned Roy previously, but at 42, we also have different coalitions. So the educational model is gamified like Harry Potter, right? So there are different houses and then they compete between mm-hmm. each other. And every student, because they submit an assignment or they evaluate somebody, they earn points. Right? So now we actually wanted to create like a dashboard on our, in the big, big TV when you enter, you know, mm-hmm. and then we wanted to have like a dashboard of all the coalition points and also not only to compare the houses, but also who are the most active students. So this could be also a good idea to build. If anybody would be up for it, I'm sure Estelle would gladly, that's our developer, Estelle would mm-hmm. gladly talk to you.
Yeah, it could be really nice to make a bit of competition.
Yes, but it's a collaborative competition, you know, among the different coalitions. It's nice because it's not per se, you know, there is nothing to lose, you know, it's only to gain.
Yeah, so GitHub itself also, if the students are using GitHub, it has a nice API, and it's both in REST but also in GraphQL, so you can choose. But in there, you can also get information that's public, so you can even get how many repositories someone has or how many stars a project has. So those might be information sources that you can also also use in there somehow.
Yeah, indeed. And actually, one of the questions that are left is there an online community to share code and ideas?
So previously I mentioned Twitter. So on Twitter, there's a lot of active communities talking about programming and code and all these sorts of things. If you're a Reddit fan, there's also a lot of subreddits about different libraries or programming languages. But there are lots of lots of ways to share code and knowledge together. Also on GitHub, so GitHub has a new feature called GitHub Discussions. So even there, people can go into discussions around certain programming languages or libraries, repositories to discuss things. So there's lots of opportunities. And also, I think it all starts with creating maybe a Twitter account or Medium or Practical Dev and look at those sites and see what kind of information they would have available.
Indeed. At what point is it necessary to make your own database in your app? It's a little bit out of context, but maybe you can tackle the question.
Yeah, so it depends. I think that's a question to answer to a lot of questions. But so you have different kinds of databases and there are different ways to create one. So I think the cool thing of now is that we have a lot of SaaS products, even built into maybe Google with Firebase or AWS as Amplify. And there are more examples of actually cloud providers or SaaS companies that are giving you access to a database that you don't have to host yourself and you can easily access. And if you're working on hobby projects or maybe school projects, you can even access them for free. So I think a point where you really create your own database in a server, I think we don't really have to do that anymore unless you're a really big company. But if you want to store some data, it has never been easier to create a database somewhere in order to store your data there.
Thank you. Let's take this one. I'm a bit new, but it seems that HTTP and JSON are the standard tools to do backend. Do you agree with that?
They're both not really tools. So HTTP is the protocol your browser or your computer uses to communicate with APIs. So whatever language you're using to create an API, you never have to do anything there yourself. So HTTP is already built in with most libraries or methods inside programming languages. So you don't really have to touch that. And JSON is typically the format of the data that's being returned. But most languages also already know how to use JSON. So both are not really tools, but more protocols or standards that are supported by most backend programming languages.
Yeah, indeed. And the last question, any interesting part-time job opportunities at Van de Brom that involves work with APIs?
At the moment, I don't think so, but yeah, feel free to look at our website. There's this whole page with careers, and if we have something, you can find it on there. But you can also reach out to me if you want to have more questions about that.
Yeah. Would you mind if, so I think everybody could contact you via Twitter, right? Is it the best way?
It is a good way, but you could also share my email in case people have questions.
Okay, fantastic. That's actually nice. I think this was the last question for today. I would like to thank you, Roy, for taking the time to do the masterclass, sharing your insights. I hope that the students enjoyed and learned a lot from the session. I would like to encourage every student to go on Roy Derk's profile on YouTube. You can find a bunch of videos on different topics over there, you know, from the previous talks. I bet you'll find some of the topics relevant to you. So, you know, this journey should not end here. You can still watch a couple of videos afterwards. Mm-hmm. Thanks a bunch, Roy, for taking the time again. And yeah, hope we're going to see each other soon at the next masterclass or so.
Yes, thank you, everyone.
And I'll be sharing with you, with the participants, the book that you shared with me. I will send it to
them.
Yes. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.